That's S-K-O-S. He's got mumps, that's what he's got.
A tribute to Peppiatt and Aylesworth, Canada's first television comedy team.
The adrenaline of doing a live show. And that's what really made live television great.
Good evening. With all the talent this country has nurtured, one curious fact keeps surfacing. We seem to have no creative product more exportable than the Canadian sense of humor. The list is endless of the comedy writers and performers who have gone on to enjoy international success in the film and television business. Well, for me, some of my fondest memories of early television are of two men who blazed this trail. Before there was SCTV, before Lorne Michaels created Saturday Night Live for NBC, even before Wayne and Schuster found international fame through a record number of appearances on the Ed Sullivan Show, there was Peppiatt and Aylesworth. In the early 1950s, the CBC was on the hunt for a comedy show and the writer-performers who could pull it off. Wayne and Schuster were enjoying great success on radio at the time, but were not yet ready to make the move to television. However, a network executive discovered another funny John and Frank team working as copywriters at an advertising agency in Toronto. With youthful enthusiasm and terror, the two men jumped at the opportunity to be part of this strange, radical new medium. The rest, as tonight's profile reveals, truly is history. 45 years later, the easier question is not who did they work with, but who didn't they work with? As I was reviewing old black and white footage in preparation for this show, I often caught myself laughing out loud in my office. Peppiatt and Aylesworth's partnership was unique. Unlike many other teams, their comic style was not built on the more traditional straight man and buffoon concept. Their performing relationship was equal in its inspired looniness. It also left me wondering, with all the international success they went on to achieve once they turned their talents solely to writing, perhaps we lost two wonderfully talented comic performers.
Sugar, what about your music?
You're right. I have been neglecting my record collection.
Now come on out with your hands up.
Give me a break, will you? Give me a break.
No use talking. I'm a cop.
I'll make a deal with you.
No use talking. I'm a cop.
I got $3 million up here.
Keep talking. I'm an ex-cop.
Well, I guess it's up to me to break the ice. What do you do for a living?
Come on, drop those guns. Fifth Brannigan at your service, ma'am.
Oh, thank goodness.
All right. Now, let's see a fair fight. Go to it.
All right, I heard, I tell you.
How do you spell that?
Well, that's scrofular AC somosasolo. That's S-K-O-E-R-S. He's got mumps, that's what he's got.
I'll start you off with some basic training.
Yes, sir.
Call out some of these streets, will you, please,
all
as we go
right,
by.
Right.
College, Grosvenor, Wellesley, change for the bluer car.
No,
please.
No.
That's no way to call out streets, for heaven's sake.
What's the matter?
You know how to call out a street? I'll show you.
On it, Rooney, Bottle, God, you do know.
Now you're getting the idea.
That's wonderful.
You know, it's been 15 years since I last saw Frank Peppiatt. That's when he moved from L.A. up here to Toronto. Gosh, I haven't even spoken to him. He doesn't have a telephone. Nobody's spoken to him. All I have is his address. I hope he's okay. My God. He lives here?
Thank you.
Hi, I came to see Frank Peppiatt.
Mr. Peppiatt sees no one.
Yeah, but I'm John Aylesworth. I worked with him for 40 years. We were partners. Surely he'll see me.
Perhaps. I'll announce you.
Gee, thanks a lot.
Ready for my close-up, Mr. Jewison.
Frank! Frank, what's happened to you? Come to your senses, man. I mean, it's the same dress, but you've changed gender.
Is it still 1960?
No, it's the 90s.
The gay 90s?
Obviously.
I guess we really became a team and started writing a lot of comedy together at McLaren Advertising, where we met in 1950, 51, I guess.
They ushered me into this office, and Frank was at a desk, and I had another desk, and we met each other, and it was craziness from then on. We just did absolutely insane things.
One night we put on newspaper hats and rulers for guns, and we were marching around the office just for fun, and we walked into the boardroom in the middle of a General Motors board meeting, and I said, "About turn!" We both turned, slammed the door, and left. God knows what those men thought.
Nobody noticed.
Peter McFarlane came to work for McLaren's as head of the television department.
Yeah, because he had gone to a television school in New York for 2 months. So that made him hot stuff.
Yeah, right. He said that they need some comedy over at CBC, and we want to do a test film of you guys because we were funny in the office.
And there wasn't anybody else. There wasn't anybody, any comedians. Or when he wanted to do a comedy show, there was Wayne and Schuster, but they had a very successful radio show. They didn't want to get into television that early. And it was 6 o'clock in the morning, the audition. We just wrote all night. And we knew we were going to do the refrigerator thing.
And the customs.
We did the custom sketch. Yeah, so we did the audition, and the CBC looked at it and said, okay.
And then they phoned us, believe it or not, said you're on every Friday at 10 o'clock for an hour.
Yeah.
Live.
After hours.
And we used to do a thing very similar to what they do on Saturday Night Live. We used to do open in the audience.
Well, tell me, Clint, what did you think of that fast knockout fight last Friday night?
I didn't see it.
You, the greatest sports authority in Canada, didn't see the championship fight last week on television?
No, I didn't. No.
Well, how come?
I was watching After Hours.
I guess it was December of 52, and we were on the air in January of 53.
It was unbelievable. I mean, to be suddenly you're doing your own show.
Stark terror. Yeah.
And also, I don't think I realized how that it was going out, you know, and so my mother and father saw it, you know. In fact, I asked her, you know, how she liked it, and she said, "Well, try to stand up straight. You're a tall boy and show it off."
We had no budget. The whole show cost $100 for an hour, including our fee.
And we had Jill Foster, of course, who was Jill Hancock at that time.
Florence Hancock.
And I had known her from, I was in a small group of players, the Blacklock players. And John said, "We need a lady to be on with us, you know." So I said, "Let's get her." And we got her, and she quit her job. We didn't quit ours. We weren't stupid. But she quit her job, and we together ever, you know, for the next 3 years.
We needed somebody to sort of hold it together, so we got a local disc jockey named Rick Campbell, and he would do the introductions and then set us up in the next sketch we were going to do, and that was it.
Why, George, you got a real fine show for you. Now, these three people that you're going to see a bit later on in the show, Frank, John, and Jill. Jill is very easy to recognize. Jill has blonde hair.
But we didn't have an audience or anything for the first couple of months, but we started to get a following because it was just a very weird, strange show. And because we were working at the agency all day, every day, we didn't have too much time to prepare.
We rehearsed in my basement at my house, and I had no real costume department. We said, "We're doing a Superman sketch. Frank's going to be Superman." They said, "Well, does he have a costume?" So my mother made the costume for me out of a pair of long white underwear and an old football jersey and put the Superman thing on the front.
Boy, what fun, though. It was like playing in a rec room, going down to the studio and just go in there and everybody was loose and nobody knew what they were doing. And
you'd forget that you were live, going out.
Yeah, it was playtime.
Well, there certainly are a lot of premiums in that box.
What did you say, Dabbler?
I said there are a lot of premiums in that box.
Oh, Dabbler, I can see you're off and running. There's going to be no holding you tonight. Will you just keep the jokes down for a minute and let me get on with the show?
Fine.
Oh, there you go again. Oh, Dabbler.
If you don't want to keep looking down at your script and up into the camera all the time, then After Hours has the answer. We call them TV Eyes. Now, Frank will read an item and demonstrate, please.
Right. Here's the late sports news. The Sioux Micmacs were edged last night by the Sioux Mac Mix. 5-0. Merle Hurlbut garnered the winning tally and the last chucker. And that's the sports news till now. So remember, you can always lose if you can win with a smile.
One guy saw us in a bar. We did the streetcar sketch that particular night. And he was in the bar, and he said, everybody stopped when they saw the streetcar thing, and they all started to laugh. And I went, it makes you feel good, you know, that somebody was watching, you know.
Yeah.
He said it was hilarious. Everybody stopped and watched it.
Every time. A guy got on this morning, tried to fool me with the old Dodge, the ticket in the mouth, gets on, does this. And I said to him, you've got that ticket in your mouth, you little scallywag. Now spit it out.
Good going.
You know what he did?
What?
Chewed it up like this. Then swallowed it. Like that.
Care to wash it down with a transfer?
Don't be smart.
We had an inspiration after a couple of weeks of doing the show. We figured, gee, this is hard doing a whole hour with just us changing stuff and things like that, and costumes and... So we found a 16-millimeter camera. We did car chases. There was one thing we did, Rocky the Racketeer. It was a series that we did.
You made it.
Yeah, but I gotta go back.
Why?
I forgot the money. He pulls up at the bank. He gets out. This time he's got the dough. He gets into the car fast because there's a cop on his tail. He drives away from the bank because the cops are on his tail. The cops tell him to stop. He finally arrives at the club Underworld and turns in. The winner! Out of the car with the money. Hooray! Into the club Underworld. Where's the cops? Here they come now. But it's too late. The checkered flag is down.
Frank was the singer and dancer of our group.
So to speak.
Yeah. I have no rhythm. None whatever.
That
I
clip,
never
if
did.
You notice, he hides behind me. John is hiding behind Jill and myself while we're doing Chattanooga Choo Choo.
Oh,
so
yeah,
funny.
But Frank was Mr. Twinkle Toes. He loved that. You're like, hey, Mr. Show Business. And I didn't know what... I can't do that.
You've got to try.
I kept trying, yeah, you know, and it was just miserable.
You got show business in your blood. Try to get in your feet.
Television started in 1952, and we started almost immediately. I mean, I got this call saying, listen, Jill, do you want to come and be on this show? Well,
6 a.m.
How old were you then?
22. So, did I want to come and do the show? You damn well. Of course I did.
Miss, How would you like a partly eaten peanut butter sandwich?
You can talk to me in your smart ways. Haven't you got any consideration? I come in here from a small town, and what do I get? Nothing but the worst. My life is meaningless. Why can't people let me alone? They start to torture me and throw jives of life at me that no one can explain. It's all too horrible.
Guess you don't like peanut butter sandwiches either.
But I often wondered why they actually thought of me, and I know what it was about. It was because I was a great audience. No, I laughed at their jokes.
That's not true. You were the only girl either one of us knew.
Yeah, but a girl who laughed. And
yeah,
I think that was
we
it.
We were lucky.
Well, I was involved with Frank because I was an actor, and I was working as a steward on Air Canada saving money to open a theater. And I didn't work in after hours. I worked in
bigger
on deal. Stage, I guess.
I think we were married at this point. So it was sort of like my husband was appearing on the show and wanted him to do well. They had him in the sketch where they had him nailed and he was playing a butler, you know, nailed to the floor. And I realized
the nails
had come up. I reach down and I pick him up and push him back.
And slam the door in his face.
I have a feeling something strange is going on.
The other day we were sitting around watching clips of her singing, and Jill was in our apartment now. She said, "Boy, did I have a lot of guts."
Yeah.
We all had a lot of guts.
Well, boy, did we ever.
That's all there was to it.
Right now, I want to show you the convenience of this wonderful new Eastinghouse refrigerator. Why, you'll be simply amazed at the room. And everything is right at your fingertips. Want lettuce? Just reach inside. And you'll find it stays wonderfully crisp and fresh. Why, when you keep your lettuce in an Eastinghouse refrigerator, it'll look just like $1 million. Thirsty? How about a nice cool bottle of pop? And you'll find a handy opener inside your Eastinghouse refrigerator. See? And remember, you can be almost sure if it's Eastinghouse.
When we got an audience, it was exciting. It was great. We had
they
like
laughed. Yeah.
50, 60 people.
Yeah.
And for the first time, it was so exhilarating to go out and in the first line, they laugh. Ah! And we didn't know timing up to that point, and it was exciting to learn that. But the beauty of those days was nobody knew what they were doing. It was just, everybody was winging it. It was just wonderful because there were no preconceived notions. We just went out and did it.
That is the way to talk. That's the way to handle it.
Well, after I bawled her out, she goes downstairs and as meek as mild as anything and makes my sandwiches.
Sure, that's the way to handle women. By the way, Ollie, what kind of sandwiches did she give you?
Orange peel on rye.
Oh, Ollie, you are in trouble. Look, why don't you do like I do? I use psychology. I'm always nice to my little wife.
Yeah.
I mean, it's a theory I've developed over the years. I always use it. I'm always nice to her. I never yell at her. I get wonderful sandwiches.
How do you do it?
I make my own lunch.
All I know, he's wearing a black trench coat, a black beret, and a black patch over one eye.
That should be easy.
Yeah.
Guess Hans isn't here yet.
Tell you what I'll do.
What?
I'll let you start her up.
Oh, wonderful. Thank
okay.
you, sir.
Now, take it easy.
Okay.
Here.
I trained a lot on this, sir.
All right. Now,
okay.
Start it up.
No. How do you expect people to fall over if you start it like that?
Hurry,
now,
sir.
Do it again and give it a good shot.
Okay, sir.
Good jolt. You're doing it right.
Oh. My favorite one was where John comes in to shave in the morning, and on the other side of the mirror, I'm there, and I mime exactly what he does. And then he realizes it's me. And I explained that his mirror image double is sick that day.
My mirror double?
Of course, everybody has a mirror double. And go ahead and shave. I'll follow you.
If you work all the time behind a mirror, don't you find it hard to follow the motions of the people?
Oh, don't find it hard at all. You see, you get to know your boss pretty well over the years.
You do, eh?
As a matter of fact, I've never worked for you, have I?
No,
and I think I can follow you. Would you like to try it?
I'd like to try it,
okay, just step out of the mirror for a minute.
Sounds like fun. Okay. Gee, Frank, you shouldn't make them work so hard. God.
What are you talking about? Who?
Your mirror double. Always primping and preening in the mirror, for goodness sakes. You make them work all the time.
See, he slipped his lid. Let's go and get a doctor or something, or a psycho.
I think my favorite was the customs sketch, which we repeated several times because everybody really liked that one. Because it was kind of definitive us, because Frank is tall and big, and I'm back then I was a skinny, shorter person. And so Frank always played a wonderful bully, so it was just this great give and take of crossing the Canadian border from Buffalo coming home to Canada.
What's your name?
Oh, my name is Fred Cosgrove, sir.
Let's see your birth certificate.
Birth certificate, got it right here. Boy, did I have a good time in Buffalo.
Yes, yes.
Gee,
wow. Thought you said your name was Fred Cosgrove.
What is it?
Says here, Fred C. Cosgrove.
Well, C, it's an nickname.
You're a liar. Well, you're lucky, because there's nothing there.
Guess not, sir.
What's that?
It's a cigarette, sir.
It's an American cigarette.
Yes, it's my last one.
You smuggler!
Smuggler? I don't even inhale.
We ended up doing like 2 after hours a week at one point. Remember?
Yeah, we were doing 2. Jeez, I've forgotten that. You're right.
Yeah.
2
Tuesdays
a week.
Tuesdays and Fridays. Because I guess they needed some saps to fill in some time.
Yeah, that's when we quit the agency, because it would be a little difficult doing 2 shows a week.
And I remember Bob McGall, I think, was in charge of something or other, and asked us up to his office and said, we want you to do a big hour show next. Big Review was already on, you see.
Yeah.
But we want you to do the Big Review next year.
It's showtime on the Big Review, so let's all gather around the Big Review.
There were like 6 dancers, there were like 8 singers, I mean, 4 or 5 cameras, a huge, you know, in the control booth, there were a lot more people. It was just huge, a big, big show, you know, 30-piece orchestra.
It was just so crazy, though. You didn't have time to think about it. Okay, next, get into the ape costume now, and you, get a put on the policeman suit.
Oh, darling, you've made me so happy. There's no one like you in the whole wide world.
Oh, Clarissa, you silly little goose. I'm just a simple country squire. Tea, darling?
Oh, love it.
And we had to write at least 3 full sketches week, sometimes 4. Plus the opening and the close. We used to have a meeting at Norman Jewison's house. I think it was every Tuesday night. They stated that they wanted more, quote, commercial comedy.
You'll never get me! You'll never take me!
I don't want you!
Out of my way, bud!
And remember, friends, you can keep things much cooler in...
Okay, Lefty Finesse, this is it. You're under arrest for selling hot refrigerators.
You'll never get me. I got an Eastinghouse heater.
Then they said they wanted more domestic stuff, you know, like the honeymooners, that kind of thing, and that's when we came up with the idea of neighbors living side by side, which is kind of a commentary on people living in apartment houses, in identical apartments, in long rows, doing identical things.
We'll have a party here all by ourselves, and it'll sound like the biggest party they've ever heard. You get the glasses and get the noisemakers. Nobody's going to think that we're not popular.
Oh, boy, that's a wonderful story, Wizard.
Yeah, I got a lot more to tell you, too, Johnny.
What a party!
Hey, that's
some party
they're having.
Yeah, I didn't know Frank was having a party tonight.
Did I?
What a party! Wow, listen. Hiya, kids. Just came over to borrow some ice, you know. Takes a lot of ice to feed 30 or 40 people.
Oh,
party!
Oh, gee, I'm having a terrific time.
party of the year.
Who's that?
This must really be getting them jealous, eh? Oh, it's wonderful.
It is not a good idea.
Yeah?
Let's sing, gang.
Okay, I'll give you the key, folks.
Fine.
Sweet Adolos.
Bye,
Adolos.
Bye, Adolos. Sweet
Have a drink. I'm having a wonderful party. It's just terrific. Let's go.
The adrenaline of doing a live show. And that's what really made live television great. And that was the fun of it. You'd get all revved up and you'd go out there and you'd do the show and you wouldn't be thinking about anything else except doing it, and all the energy was there. And then when tape came in, it was a case, well, we have to do a retake on that. We have to fix the lights.
Or don't worry about it. We'll fix it in editing.
Yeah. You know. And they bring out ladders, and you knew, oh, God, an hour wait, and the audience is muttering, and tape took all that away, which is probably why there was the demise of a variety show.
Go! Go!
Hurry! Oh, you bunglers! You dead bunglers!
I will take care of you myself!
That pig sticker doesn't bother me, Hansy. Try this on for size.
I don't want a ricochet romance. I just want to shoot you.
But yeah.
You're not falling.
I took the precaution of removing the bullets from your gun and putting in blanks.
But I knew that you put in blanks, so I put real bullets back in.
And I knew that you knew that I knew, so I put blanks back in.
But I knew that you knew that I knew that you knew that I knew that you put blanks in, so I put real bullets back in.
And I knew that you knew that I knew that you knew that I knew that you knew, so I put blanks back in the gun.
But I knew that you knew that 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 I knew that you put blanks in, so I put real bullets back in.
I didn't know that. Saying there were real bullets in the gun?
That's right.
I'm dead.
We sang a little bit like in the musical Medic, yeah. You know. Oh, there's a big, big sketch with dancers and singers and, you know.
That's the kind of thing we could do when we finally got on the big review with a big band.
That got a tremendous amount of wonderful reviews and wonderful talk, that particular sketch, Musical Medic, because it was very timely because there were about 30 medical shows on at that time. And then we did it, you know, one with music.
To Musical Medic, and now it's time to bring you those side-splitting cut-ups of silly surgery, those medical maniacs who'll keep you in stitches, Dr. Frank Heartburn Peppiatt and Dr. John Weak Eyes Aylesworth.
Must be the place.
Yes, it looks like an operating room, all right.
Say, you know, a funny thing happened to me on the way to the hospital today.
Oh, what was that?
Well, I saw Dr. Rumpelmeyer tiptoeing past the drugstore. Why was he tiptoeing past the drugstore? He didn't want to wake up the sleeping pill. Hey, you know, I wanted a patient of mine to take milk baths, but he couldn't afford it.
Well, what did he do?
He stuck a cow up on the ceiling and took a shower.
Well,
he must have had quite a lot of pull there, right?
Here now.
Oh, well, I'll introduce them then. Ladies and germs.
Hey, that's a sneaky one.
Oh, there. You know that. It's wonderful. And now, it gives me great pleasure to present that great guest patient. He's the sickest man in television, and he comes direct from a 2-year run at the Toronto General Hospital. And here he is, Cosmo Cooper.
I got earache. I got headache. Got backaches, who could ask for anything more?
Of course, we were all full of energy, let's face it. We were young and didn't know what we were doing, and we were learning and getting better at what we did and getting better at writing and everything. And youth had a lot to do with it.
Yeah, it was all kind of pretty much happening very quickly.
Like a blur, it was.
Because at the end of that year, we found that Lever Brothers wanted to sponsor our show next year and make it a half hour and do 40 shows the next year. Many, many titles they had. We had, but eventually called it On Stage, which is really brilliant, but that's what they called it.
What the heck?
On stage, everybody.
Once again, no cue cards. We memorized everything on the whole show.
So we were basically writing the show on a weekend and then rehearsing the rest of the week. And we didn't have a day off for 3 years.
But it was fun.
Come out and take your opening line. And here they are to meet you now.
Peter McFarlane, Norman Campbell, Norman Jewison. They're the only three directors we worked for.
That was it.
But from a standpoint of comedy, those are the guys.
I think they were ahead of their time. We were doing Superman sketches before they did it on the Steve Allen show. We were much stranger, I think, than any of the late night shows in America. And a lot of it was due to them. They also had a great feeling for music and for construction of medleys and interesting, clever pieces of dialogue that would fit in, and they could write for anybody.
Hello? Hello. Aunt Mary?
Oh, hello, John.
Hey, Aunt Mary, what happened to Poopsie? I told you I had to have that dog by today. I want to surprise Peggy for her birthday.
Oh, didn't you get my letter, John?
What letter?
Well, I wrote you that I shipped...
We never had any particular style of comedy that we did. We just did situations that would make people laugh because they recognized themselves in that kind of a situation.
I know Peggy's just going to love that dog. Bye.
Bye.
Bye. Gee, I wonder what happened to that letter.
Dear John, your little Poopsie is arriving on the 3 o'clock train Saturday afternoon.
Oh.
His Poopsie. Oh, I better seal it up.
Go on.
Yeah. I know you can't wait until you take little Poopsie into your arms and give her a great big hug.
Oh.
So I know you won't want to be late at the station. And your little Poopsie will be so happy to see you again. Love, Mary.
Oh, no, he couldn't.
Well, there it is in black and white. This Poopsie's obviously a nickname for some blonde named Mary.
I'm glad you know about it, because I've been trying to keep it a secret for weeks from Peggy.
Well, how long has this been going on?
Oh, I don't know. I guess I've wanted to do it ever since we got married.
What?
You know, I've shopped around, but I couldn't find one I really could get excited about until last month. Then I came across Poopsie, and it was love at first sight.
Well, what about Peggy?
Oh, hey, look, don't tell her, eh? I don't want her to know until I bring Poopsie here.
You're bringing her here?
Maybe someday Poopsie will have little ones of her own, and our little ones and her little ones will all grow up together.
Here, stop waving back! Be practical, boy!
Never mind.
All right, this is Poopsie. Bye!
The thing I do remember is that sketch that, I don't know if you have it, where John is on the telephone and he's speaking to someone. He's sort of stalling away, and the camera pulls back and you see the staircase behind him with smoke pouring down it. Firemen running up and down the stairs with huge axes. And the whole place is a bedlam, and this guy is trying to be so calm and get his insurance fixed.
Yeah, you bet, George. Say, George, what I'm calling you about, you know that fire insurance you were telling me about yesterday? Well, I'll take it.
You know the weird part about it, most people don't realize, is that it's such a rare talent. Sketch writing is so hard to do. I think it's harder than almost anything. I mean, even good writers, like me, I can't write sketches. I mean, it requires a certain twisted mind. It does require a certain talent. It's extremely hard to do it, because it's got to be concise, and you've got to hit it right,
Well, I'll take this square. Aww. See, I win.
Oh, no. Oh, Campbell, you can't win that way. Obviously, ladies and gentlemen, it's a stalemate. So we'll have to settle this contest in our usual way. We'll have a duel. Now, here's a weapon for you and a weapon for you. Now go away somewhere and fight it out. Will you please, kids? We'll resume our game in just a moment. One of them will be back in just a moment. Well, good shooting, Posey.
I know we were getting awfully tired in the last few on stages. We did a lot of repeat stuff. We did things that people like the musical medic and
plus the fact we both got married, and we had we had children
too. Yeah.
You know, which made a big difference, because you can write at home, but you can't act at home. We really wanted to do the best thing for us.
The whole thing depended on us to do 40 weeks with us doing comedy all the way through, to write it and perform it, and it really, we were a wreck by the end of that.
Written by Frank Peppiatt, John Aylesworth, and Joe Keller.
When we finished on stage, we had decided we were going to write, and that's what we did, right?
Yeah.
I went under the hit parade, and Frank went under the Jackie Ray show.
Jackie Ray show, yeah. And here's Duffy, and you did Front Place Challenge, and
after 2 years of Cross Canada Hit Parade, then I started Front Page Challenge and stuck with that.
You had to do a couple of shows a week to make a living, really.
Frank Peppiatt and John Aylesworth. During the past 15 years, they created or wrote the following TV shows. After Hours, Big Review, On Stage, The Andy Williams Show, Front Page Challenge, Music 60, Here's Duffy, The Perry Como Show, Cross Canada Hit Parade, The Barris Beat, The Steve Lawrence Edie Gourmet Show, Come Fly With Me, TV Guide Awards, Music Makers, Showtime, and specials for Judy Garland, Dean Martin, Maurice Chevalier, Juliet,
and
Dinah
one of the most prophetic specials we did was the Bing Crosby special, and his guest was Perry Como. And so we flew down to L.A. and did that show, and that's where he met Perry, and Perry said, would you come and do our show next year? 1 week you'd have Ethel Merman, the next week you'd have Jimmy Durante and Bob Hope and with Louis Armstrong. All these wonderful people, and our regulars on the show were Don Adams and Paul Lynde and Kay Ballard. And Jack Duffy, as a matter of fact, from Toronto. It was fun to write for all those people.
Say hello, Perry, please.
Hello, Perry, please.
Tell Perry what you think of him.
Well, say, I think you got a swell show. But I don't think much of your singing.
The first 13 weeks of Judy Garland was done by some people, and she was very unhappy.
The first 5 weeks, really.
Yeah, that's right.
And then
they called us in New York and asked us to come out and save the show, which we didn't do.
It's hard to save a show when the star won't get him on the stage to do it.
She'd never done weekly television. And people haven't done weekly television. I mean, they finish a big show, and you phone them the next day and say, hey, let's talk about next week. And they get very upset. We played her and Mel Torme, who was the musical director, a tape of Rich Little, and they said, wow, this guy's wonderful. So he was living in Ottawa, right?
Yeah.
And I phoned him and said, and Rich said, we'll talk to my manager, Gib Kerr. And I said, Gib, they want Rich on the Judy, we want Rich on the Judy Garland show on CBS, the full network.
And Gib said, gee, I'm sorry, but Rich has got a date in Brockville that night at the Chamber of Commerce, you know. A $30 gig, and I don't think we can get out of it. I'm in the background going, you idiot! The Judy Garland show! Are you crazy?
Well, the road gets rougher, gets lonelier and tougher. Oh, don't crowd me. With hope you burn up, tomorrow he may turn up.
Alfred Hitchcock.
There's just no let-up. The livelong night or day.
Walter Brennan.
Ever since the world began, there's nothing shared in there. One man, woman. They're looking for the man that got away.
So they were always coming up with ideas, and that's what it's all about today. It isn't enough, really, to do just the impressions. You've got to have a hook to do them. You've got to have a routine to put these voices in. And that's what they were good at. They were always great at coming up with fresh ideas.
Dwight Hemian, a friend of ours, was hired to produce and direct Sinatra's first special based on his album, A Man and His Music. So they called it A Man and His Music. And Dwight wanted us to do it, and Sinatra agreed. So we got time off from Hullabaloo and flew out to Los Angeles. And that show won the Emmy for the best musical show of the year. He had a thing called It Was a Very Good Year. One song. When I was 17, it was a very good year. When I was 21, when I was 35, when I was 40.
It was a big hit that year.
So we took each segment and put songs in that reflected that age.
The young Sinatra,
his
the middle age.
You know. Yeah. And we changed the set from summer, winter, spring, and fall.
But one of the reasons that we did well in the States was partly, or mostly, maybe, because of what we learned here.
Yeah.
We could literally do everything. We came up with what the sets were, The idea for the dance numbers, the special material, and the whole form of the show, the format, and all that stuff, which is very few people did that, so we were very lucky to have learned how to do it all.
I mean, if it wasn't for Frank and John, I don't know whether I would have really made it. Well, I might have, but, I mean, they really discovered me in a way. And so I think of them when I miss a plane or a show goes bad. I blame them. Otherwise, I could have just, you know, stayed in Ottawa and become an aluminum siding salesman.
And we wrote that.
And it's from the Lovin' Spoonful. It's their new record. If you'll come with me, I think we can find it back here. Come on.
1965, we were doing Hullabaloo in New York, and we did around 40, 42 Hullabaloo.
Well, it's all gone. It's all gone now. There is very little variety in television. It went to the 60s, and there were all the great variety shows from Milton Berle and Jackie Gleason and the sketches and Show of Shows and all of that. And then about the end of the 70s, I think it just sort of...
Situation comedies took over.
Yeah, situation comedies took over in the 70s. And then you did Hee Haw for years.
Yeah. How did you get into Hee Haw? I mean, how did that begin?
We saw a Newsweek magazine. We were going to lunch, and it was on a newsstand. And Loretta Lynn was there, and the front cover, the headline was, Country Music Hot. So we said,
that's
it. So when we got back to the office, we looked up the rating. Top 10 was all country sitcoms. Beverly Hillbillies, Green Acres, all these things. So we figured, wait a minute, there's never been a country western comedy variety show. We'll put the two together.
Well, it's been on 23 years, 600 one-hour shows.
Yeah.
And we owned it,
Welcome to Hee-Haw, starring Buck Owens and Roy Black.
Don Herron was the first fellow we thought of in doing a country show, because, as I say, we didn't know anything about country. So we brought John down to be Charlie Farquharson in your KORN news.
And Gordy Tapp we brought down as well.
And we really needed Gordy because he knew the few comedians that existed in Nashville.
In that first year, it did so much for country music that on the Country Music Awards that year, John and I won the award for Country Music Men of the Year. We still have the awards at home.
Yeah. Often, when we were really busy writing a lot of shows later on in our career, Frank would write the first half and I'd write the second half. We fit them together and there was hardly any difference.
Right.
Because we were that simpatico in our thinking, so it made it very easy.
If you think alike, you know, you think funny the same sort of way.
Yeah.
And you can and develop things rather than saying, you know, oh, no, that isn't funny. I don't think that's funny. And the other guy, and then you say something, the other guy says, I don't think that's funny.
Yeah, that's not a team.
You're in a lot of trouble.
It's two guys fighting. You
know? You're in a lot of trouble.
That's a writer and a producer.
Yeah.
But a couple of guys writing together, they have to have the same vision in order to make it all work. And it has to be your own vision and what you want to do. So you have to agree on the kind of guy. Sure, we would argue about particular punchline, but it would always be for the same end,
building on the idea all the time.
We never had any particular style of comedy that we did. Basically, before we got an audience, in the very beginning and after hours, we just did what amused us, hoping it would amuse other people. Then when we started to get an audience in after a couple of months, we began to realize what made other people laugh, and also we enjoyed it too. But there was no particular style. It was just comedy is something that makes people laugh, and if it made them laugh, it made us happy.
A tinkling piano in the next apartment. Those stumbling words that told you what my heart meant.
At that time, the CBC was so small, and everybody kind of knew everybody, and it was a great pleasure. It was just a great pleasure, and it was fun to work with the two of you. I mean, I used to look forward to coming to the rehearsals, because I never knew what was going to happen. And so it was a great period, you know. I guess I'd like to do it again.
When you did that to me, I knew somehow it had to be.
when I think of John and Frank, I smile because they brought so much laughter and life into my work as a director at the CBC. And I think they were impudent. They would attack anything. They were full of satire at a time when people were afraid. And I think we were all young and innocent. And that's the best part of it.
It sure is, yeah.
When the subway comes, it'll take all the fun out of streetcar. No more jolts. No more streets to call out badly. No more cars to hit. No more doors to close. But subwaying's for younger men. I guess I'll be heading for the barn. Don't pity me, son. Don't pity me because I've had a good life on the rails. Had a good life. And pretty soon, I'll be heading for that big car barn up in the sky.
You shouldn't talk like that.
I bought one of those old cars, you know.
You bought one of them?
Yes, I'm living in it. Why don't we go and take the streetcar to your streetcar home?
That's great.
Wonderful.
We can sit around all day and yell out a medley of streets.
Oh, gosh, it'll be just like the old days.
Just like the old days.
College Street, Bluer Street.
Just a minute.
No, you're saying it too clear. You didn't remember what I taught you.
Oops.
River Street, Bridget Street.
That's better.
Don't know.
River,
Cardinal.
River,
next.
Nah, you
River
got
Street.
It. Now you
River
got
Street.
It.
Hey, let's go.
Coming to rehearsal, being in the studio, being on the air, that was the most exciting period I've ever known.
We had the same whimsy, I guess you could call it. We enjoyed the same things, we laughed at the same things, and it just went on from there.
As you can see, the humor of Peppiatt and Aylesworth is very much alive and well as they continue to develop new projects. John Aylesworth and his son are currently creating a new variety show. As well, John is working on an American version of Front Page Challenge. Frank Peppiatt has just finished co-writing the book and lyrics for a new musical called Capone, which will be showcased in Toronto and London, England this fall. He also has a novel in the works entitled Gershwin, Golf Shoes, and Murder. We wish them the best of luck in all their latest ventures. Now we turn from television to the